So these pictures taken earlier today in Palestinian areas.
We take it back to Larry Korb, who's graciously joining us on the phone and helping us understand exactly how the U.S. military would formulate a response. Larry, even though Osama bin Laden wasn't necessarily considered a force during the Reagan administration, certainly you had procedures in place for how to coordinate a response to a terrorist attack. What were they?
Well, obviously, but there are things that you can do, but you have to know who to respond against,
right.
And that's the problem.
But I mean, in terms of sort of, you know, do you have the National Military Command Center in the basement of the Pentagon? Are they
leading? Well, yeah, obviously. I mean, what you do then is you have the forces in the area. Most probably, you would have ships with cruise missiles or planes with cruise missiles that would attack. Remember, we did attack bin Laden after the blowing up of the embassies in Africa in 1998. We did attack his camp.
Right.
So, yes, I mean, we have forces all around the world. We have bombers that can fly from the United States that attack any place in the world. So that's probably what we would do if we found the people. But that's the problem you have in this new era, that these groups don't belong to any one nation, and there's no real central headquarters that you can hit.
Also, you generally, as I understand it, you, meaning the Pentagon, I mean leaders at the Pentagon, have a list of response targets already prepared before an attack ever occurs against the United States. There's already a list that you deploy when given the go-ahead by the White House, correct?
Well, that's right. I mean, you have a number. I mean, we have very good intelligence. Our technical intelligence is terrific. We know where these people are, and if we can make a link, yes, then we can go ahead and go after them. The problem is making that link, because the United States stands for decency in the world and, you know, innocent until you're proven guilty. So it's hard for us to do some of the things that I think the relatives of these poor folks in New York today are going to want us to do because of the procedures that we follow.
Right. Now, I want to take you back again to a statement of a Taliban official, obviously the Taliban government being that in charge of Afghanistan. He said, quote, bin Laden does not have the facilities to orchestrate such a major assault within the United States. Some other terrorism experts are saying that he may be the only person who has the kind of organization to orchestrate this kind of attack. Where do you stand?
Yeah, I think he's the only one. And remember, we're not talking, I mean, he didn't buy missiles or anything like that. What they basically did was hijack four airplanes.
Right.
And he certainly has the wherewithal to do that.
Now, the ultimate go-ahead for any sort of strike, when it comes, if it comes, if it is determined fairly clearly that we have figured out who is responsible for this, how does the chain of command work? I mean, who gives the go-ahead, and where does it have to sort of, does it originate from the top, from the commander-in-chief, the president?
Right. Only the president can order military action, and then he sends the order to the Secretary of Defense, who transmits it to the field commander. But only the president has that authority under our Constitution.
Now, when you say he transmits it to the field commander, does he speak to Donald Rumsfeld?
Yeah, the president.
And then it goes to the Joint Chiefs, or how exactly does it go down the...
Normally what the president would do is he would sign the order or direct the Secretary of Defense to execute whatever the contingency plan would be. The Secretary of Defense would sign the order, and the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff would transmit it through military channels to the commander-in-chief of the Pacific, the commander-in-chief of our Atlantic forces, or whoever is the area commander. The commander-in-chief of the Central Command, for example, would have responsibility for that area. That was General Schwarzkopf's job during the Gulf War. He was the commander of the Central Command.
Mr. Korb, it's John Scott with just a general question. I mean, what are our options? We lobbed some cruise missiles at Osama bin Laden years ago. That didn't seem to have much of an effect. What kinds of operations, just in broad strokes, can we consider here?
Well, I think you have to start, you have to stop these before these people get into the country, get onto your planes, or get these weapons. And it has to be done by the international community. As powerful as we are, the United States cannot do this by itself, because without working with the rest of the world, we can't get these people. And that's the frustrating thing. You saw what happened when we sent the FBI to Aden to investigate what happened with the coal. We didn't get the cooperation. Unfortunately, the world has to deal with this, and the United States needs to take the lead in getting the world to establish guidelines about dealing with these terrorists, because if they can do it here, they can do it anyplace.
Let's say we can trace the perpetrators of this to some country somewhere in the world. Would you suggest to the president, if you were still advising him, would you suggest some kind of an armed invasion to go in and get whoever's responsible?
Yeah, I would suggest going in and getting them and working through the local authorities if you could. I mean, because a lot of our friends around the world will be more than happy to help us. And so if the person is in country X, you work with the law enforcement and armed forces there to get them out and bring them to justice.
Larry Korb, we thank you very much of the Council on Foreign Relations, former Assistant Secretary of Defense under the Reagan administration.
Nice to be with you.
Thank you once again. We take it now to correspondent Rick Leventhal. Perhaps the heroes of this day will be those who have been performing rescue on those who are trapped inside. Rick Leventhal is with one of those individuals right now. Rick?
Countless rescues performed by Bill Quick here with the New York City Fire Department. I know you were on vacation and this happens. Take us through what your call, your first call, and what you did after that.
I drove in. I live in Long Beach. I drove in my car. I could see the smoke coming from the World Trade Center. I have a radio in my car. I can hear everything that's going on. Just mayhem. First plane hit. Second plane hit. The first time I got there, I ran up to the building and a police officer said, I got people trapped down the subway. So I went into the subway, went downstairs, got people up. People are bleeding, screaming, crying. And I just said, just come upstairs, go to your left, just keep going to your left. Just find the ambulance, go to your left, go to your left. Within 2 to 3 minutes after that, the first collapse happened of the building. I don't know which building it was. It came down, I was outside, I ran behind a pillar. I got down on the floor. I covered in my coat. I didn't have a mask at the time. I covered my coat, and I was trying to survive. And it was total pitch black for like 10 to 15 minutes. There was an EMT next to me. He goes, I think I'm burnt. So I looked at him. I said, no, you're not burnt. You're just covered with soot, hot soot and everything like that. After that, he went on his way. I went and got a mask. I went back in the building. And I went searching for more people, and we found out that there was nobody else left down the subway.
And I'm here to update you all on the activities of the federal government in response to this morning's attacks on our country. As you heard from President Bush a short time ago, the federal government is acting to help local communities with search and rescue and emergency management operations, to take all appropriate precautions to protect our citizens, and to identify those responsible for these despicable attacks on the American people. While some federal buildings have been evacuated for security reasons and to protect our workers, your federal government continues to function effectively. We have a federal emergency response plan, and at President Bush's direction, we are implementing it. We began to implement it immediately after the first attack in New York this morning. We contacted American forces and embassies throughout the world and placed them on high alert. The United States Secret Service immediately secured the President, the Vice President, and the Speaker of the House, and they are all safe. They have also secured members of the National Security Team, the President's Cabinet, and senior staff. As you know, President Bush was in Sarasota, Florida, when the first attack occurred this morning. Air Force One has now landed at Offutt Air Force Base in Omaha, Nebraska, and the President is in a secure location. He is in continuous communication with the Vice President and key members of his Cabinet and National Security Team. Vice President Cheney and our National Security Advisor, Condoleezza Rice, are in a secure facility at the White House. I have just come from there. The Secretary of Transportation and other members of our White House senior staff are gathered at a command center there, and we are coordinating with other branches of our federal government. The Secretary of Defense remains at the Pentagon, and the Secretary of State is en route back to Washington from his trip to South America. President Bush is conducting a meeting of the National Security Council as we speak. They are meeting President Bush from his location and other members from different locations in Washington and other locations. As many of you have been reporting, the Federal Aviation Administration ordered all airports closed and all planes which were in the air were directed to land at the nearest airport. International flights were diverted to alternate locations outside of the United States. Transportation Secretary Mineta has directed the Federal Aviation Administration to suspend operations until at least noon tomorrow. So no airline flights will operate until at least then and until the FAA announces that operations will be resumed. Secretary Mineta has also issued orders controlling the movement of all vessels in United States navigable waters. The Federal Emergency Management Agency has activated 8 urban search and rescue task forces in New York, and 4 of these highly trained teams are at work here in Washington at the Pentagon. Every federal agency has implemented continuity of operations plans to make sure the government continues to function effectively. While the markets closed today because of the situation in Manhattan, the United States financial system has continued to operate. Banks have been open all day. The Federal Reserve has operated regularly and continuously. The Department of Health and Human Services has mobilized medical personnel and supplies to provide help to local authorities who are working so diligently to respond and try to help the victims of these terrible attacks. President Bush has committed the full resources of our intelligence and law enforcement communities to identify and bring to swift justice those responsible for these despicable attacks. The Department of Justice is setting up a hotline for families who fear that their relatives may have been victims of one of these attacks, and we will be announcing that telephone number shortly. Our fellow citizens and our freedom came under attack today, and no one should doubt America's resolve. President Bush and all our country's leaders thank the many Americans who are helping with rescue and relief efforts. We ask our fellow Americans for your prayers for the victims, for their families, for the rescue workers, and for our country. Thank you all very much, and we will continue to update you as information is available and confirmed.
So Karen Hughes apparently taking no questions. Karen Hughes, the senior advisor to the president, giving us an update on the status of some of the most senior people in Washington. The president is most recently landed at Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska. She said the president is at a secure location, but she did not necessarily suggest that he is on the base itself. One believes he probably still is. The vice president and the national security advisor, Condoleezza Rice, are in the White House in a secure location, probably that basement bunker there.
It is not very often that this nation is brought to a standstill, but on today, it has happened. Many people here in New York City, in Washington, D.C., all over the country, staring at their televisions, unable to believe what they are seeing happening before them. You see it here on the corner of 48th Street and 6th Avenue in New York City, outside the Fox News Channel headquarters. We have seen this sight in many locations. People just simply in shock at what they're seeing. Who could have thought that an attack of this magnitude would happen in the United States of America? We have had officials planning for such an attack for some time, but many ordinary citizens thought that something like this could never actually happen. So much security in place, so many times that defense officials and others have war-gamed this out and planned for an attack. But on this day, it has happened. No one able to figure out why, particularly September 11th, the year 2001. One person has mentioned that it was supposed to be tomorrow that an associate of Osama bin Laden was due to be sentenced in New York. And others have mentioned that they believe Osama bin Laden is perhaps the only terrorist with the kind of organization who could plan something this massive and this deadly. The United States government not confirming anything of the kind. The Afghan government, which has been accused of for some years of harboring Osama bin Laden, rushing to say that they have no knowledge of this and they condemn it. However, they have for years not given Osama bin Laden up to the United States, despite repeated requests from Washington. They are also saying that they do not believe Osama bin Laden is capable of this. There may be many in Washington who believe otherwise at this hour. We're waiting for more briefings to come in, some planning at the Department of Defense. As you know, Secretary Rumsfeld is still there at this hour. others with officials in New York City. We are going to bring those to you just as soon as they happen. They're going to be happening just sort of suddenly, and as they do, we're going to bring them to you here on the Fox News Channel.